Now, after we talked about how local government does it here. Now, after we talked about the osteoclast, we also have to see what's going on with the osteoclast. And in the Peric, I had a really nice conversation with some of you, and there was already the question what's going on with those two osteoclasts and osteoclasts, and they are really tightly connected with each other, and that's not something you see now in this block of the slides. Now, the osteoclast differentiation is regulated by osteoblasts and stromal cells of the bone marrow, but you know the stromal cells. I only talk about the osteoclast now. We have two molecules that are produced by osteoblasts, that is FCSF and Renko. They are called macrophage colony stimulating factor, as well as receptor activator of nuclear factor kappa B ligand. Gosh, don't memorize those terms. You have to know the abbreviations. So MCSF you have to know, and you have to know Renko, and then please keep in mind that L means ligand. So if you don't know the R-A-N-K, I don't care, but try to keep in mind this is ligand. That means that one is something to attach somewhere, right? Now, osteoblasts is very important, that's why it's red here, control osteoblast differentiation, but not their function. So they are going to make sure that we develop osteoblasts, but when the osteoblasts are made, the osteoblasts themselves need an external trigger to actually function that is independent of the osteoblasts. Now, how do we do that? How do we make osteoblasts? We start with a monocyte. Remember that it's macrophage lineage? And then we have the MCSF receptor formed on the surface of the monocytes, and then we have a ligand, MCSF ligand, that is made by our osteoblast. Okay, this is like our osteoblast. And the MCSF is going to attach at the MCSF receptor, and then this little thing here changes to become a macrophage. And the macrophage will then have a receptor on the outside that is red, right? And now we have on the surface of the osteoblast, the ligand, Renko. Now guess what happens? Oh, not yet, sorry. We have the thyroid parathyroid hormone that is regulating actually the production of MCSF as well as Renko. That means our parathyroid will regulate the activity of osteoblasts that will then indirectly regulate also the osteoblastogenesis. So if our parathyroid doesn't work properly, this whole system of osteoblastogenesis will be disturbed, because then our osteoblasts can't make properly MCSF or Renko. Now, we had the MCSF ligand attaching to the MCSF receptor to make the macrophage. The macrophage then has to rank on the surface, which will then enable the macrophage not only to fuse with other macrophages to make a multinucleate osteoblast precursor, but also to attach this multinucleate osteoblast precursor with the rank to Renko. The rank ligand and rank, they're touched together, right? Now that two are the osteoblast precursor multinucleated, attached to an osteoblast. And that is the moment when the cell is actually committing to the osteoblastogenesis. Now at this point, it's a way of no return for them. As soon as they're attached here, they have to become an osteoblast. There's no other things possible anymore. Now the osteoblast precursor, as soon as it's committed to becoming an osteoblast, will detach from the osteoblast and become a resting osteoclast. And now it's waiting for what happens next. Now we have this major osteoclast coming to a region of the bone that is some kind of weakening or a microcrack or something like that. And then it will attach to the bone. And and will maybe so seal themselves off in those areas where those little foot-like structures, so the podosomes, will combine with the via a big protein with the osteochondrin on the bone surface to seal off this area here. And then underneath this enclosed area will develop our bone resorption zone or our Holship's lacunae or sub-osteoblast zone. Now we have when we look at this step here where we commit our osteoblast precursor to osteoblastogenesis, so not that, no way of return. We have many of those ligands on the surface of each osteoblast. So in theory, there are a lot of different osteoblast precursor cells that could attach to one single osteoblast to commit to osteoblastogenesis, right? Now, the osteoblast is kind of regulating that by simultaneously also making something that is called osteoprotegerin that is attaching to the Renko, to the ligand. And now it's already occupied. It's basically inhibiting another osteoblast precursor to attach and to differentiate. That makes sure that there is a balance between osteoblasts and how many osteoblasts we have. Otherwise, we have too many osteoblasts, and when we have too many osteoblasts, we eat up the bone faster than the osteoblasts can actually make new bone. That will cause a weakening of the bone structures. In case you have a pathology where you actually have more active osteoblasts, like osteoporosis, where you have more osteoblasts and osteoblasts, then we can use a medication that is called denosumab to block that off, to stop the destruction of the bone tissue. Again, denosumab, medical, forget it, just as where I am. Now let's look at how we get from the inactive osteoblast to an active osteoblast. So this inactive osteoblast has inside a couple of vesicles. They are contain acid, that's why they are called acidified vesicles. There are protons in there. On the surface of those vesicles, you can find proton pumps, H plus ATPs. You already have seen those in a couple of other lectures. Then you find on the surface of the osteoblast here in green, the alpha, B, beta 3, and green channels. And then you find inside the osteoblast, you find microtubules. Now, the osteoblast comes to an area of the bone where there's a microgranule whatsoever. And that is when we have all those alpha B, beta 3, endocrine molecules collecting on the so-called podosomes on one area of the osteoblast that is then making a contact here with the bone via this bridge. So this integrin is connecting the podosomes towards the osteochondrin on the surface of the bone. And then it kind of seals it off. I'm coming here now, and then every finger that is connecting to the bone makes now this bridge. That means the space underneath my hand now, that is the space where we can make then our lacunae. And then the acidified vesicles will start to align along those microtubules and will fuse with the surface of the osteoblast, with the inferior surface of the osteoblast that is towards the Holship's lacuna. Now the vesicles getting opened via exocytosis, leaving basically our proton pumps on the surface of this ruffled border of the osteoblast. Now, the bone departation starts the moment we have our integrin and the osteochondrin complex established, and then we also have F-actin in the filamentous actin in the area, and this whole thing is called sealing zone. The protons that are released via the proton pumps into the Holship's lacuna, they are generated by an enzyme that is called carbonic anhydrase 2, and that not only makes protons but also CO2 and water. but from CO2 and water, but that leads us with this carbon here, and that has to be somehow neutralized. You don't want to keep it in the cells because it makes the cells sick. Therefore, we have here also pumps that make sure that we get the chloride bicarbonate, the bicarbonate out of the cell to keep our osteoclast healthy, right? Because they can much easier handle the chloride, because what they are doing with the chloride is they just spit it out via chloride channels on their rubber zone, and then the chloride is joining the protons that are already done from the proton pumps on the surface. Now when you put chloride and protons together, then you get hydrochloric acid. Now, anyone have ever tried to put hydrochloric acid on a bone? No investigations here, huh? But you have perhaps saw that in any of those CSI or whatever detective shows. So when you put hydrochloric acid on a bone, it starts making those white foam-like structure. That is because the hydrochloric acid eats up the inorganic part, the hydroxyl appetite of the bone structures. It freezes basically the inorganic part. Now, we have 65% inorganic part of the bone, and we still need to get rid of the 35% organic part of the bone matrix, right? And the osteoclasts, they spit out an enzyme that's called cathepsin K, but is inactive as long as in a neutral environment. But now it's spit into an acidic environment because we already have the hydrochloric acid here, right? And the enzyme really loves acidic environment because it gets activated by the acidic environment and starts now eating the organic part of the bone. It ensures that we eat everything up from the bone. Now, if this whole process, the balance between eating osteoclasts and bone-forming osteoclasts is disturbed, then we get something that is called osteopetrosis, also called marble bone disease. Now, the whole idea is that you have an increase at the end of this disease, you have a decreased thickness of bones because you have more bone matrix than you have a spongy bone. You have more dense bone than you have spongy bone. Now you think, like, why is that bad? First of all, you don't have enough space for bone marrow. That is really bad for your blood production. However, when you bake cookies and you have too much flour, not enough milk and water or whatsoever, liquid stuff, then your cookies get really dry and dense. But as soon as you pick them up, they are getting crumbly, right? And then that is the same idea with the bones. When you have more osteoclasts than osteoclasts, you have more density, you have less water in there, and you're having therefore a high density dry structure that is crumbly, and then you can have the marble bone disease where you have easy things like when I do this, I could break my fingers by just pumping my hand on the stem. Then you have also osteosclerosis, that is a form of osteopetrosis, that is an increase of bone mass due to the increase of osteoblastic activity. So you can either have an osteoclast that are not working properly, or you can have too many osteoclasts that are working. Both leads to having too dense bones, which are leading to becoming brittle and causing easily bone breaks. Osteoporosis is something that happens mainly in women when the hormonal household changes, because it is associated with estrogen. And the estrogen is stimulating the production of osteoporosis. Now, osteoporosis, when we go reading from there, that was on the top of the osteoblasts to reduce the osteoclasts, right? And that would be regulating our balance between osteoclasts and osteoclasts. If that is not guaranteed, then we get those brittle bones. The density basically fractures because we get more dense bone on the outside, but we don't get this nice spongy bone on the inside. And that can cause two bone fractures with minor impact. So you can go basically down the stairs and break your hip simply by just moving the foot down on the next stair. Not only women can get that, men can also get osteoporosis. What you can do against that is by having vitamin D supplementations and calcium supplementations, because when you have osteoporosis, you also have a deficit of calcium in your body, and the osteoclasts will make the whole situation worse by eating one of the present of healthy bone, eating up that one, to make more calcium present for the rest of the body. So eat your fish, drink your milk, go out in the sun, and you will be fine. And for the ladies, you're also young to be in menopause, but when you get there, look into the options for vitamin D supplements. Do not eat vitamin D just as prevention. It doesn't work like this. You can't have preventive vitamins, and too much vitamins actually toxic for the development of your babies in case you want to get pregnant, so too much is also not good. Now, osteogenesis is the formation. We are done with all the cell stuff. We are now going to the big bones. Osteogenesis is the process where we make bones, and we have two different ways of making bones. One is called the intramembranous ossification, and the other one is the endochondral ossification. Endochondral ossification is the replacement of cartilage with bones. Intramembranous ossification is you make a bone inside a membranous structure, and that is, for example, relevant when we make our neurocranium, or flat portion of the neurocranium. We have that membrane, and we lay osteoblast matrix immediately in the center, and the air will then spread and forming the different bone structures. Can you please put on your mask? We have the here at the back of the head, you can see those cicula forming. And then we have the spicula, those bones and those forming on the surface of the membrane, and on the superficial surface of the membrane and the deep surface of the membrane. That means when you then will go in 2 or 3 weeks to open up the, after you've done your organs, then you will eventually open up your cranium. Then you have to go through 2 layers of bone, the outer bone layer and the inner bone layer. Between those 2 bone layers, you find a spongy center that's called the bloid. It's very easy when you then go with the bone saw and cut through the cranium. At first, it makes a lot of noise, and then you find dark colored tissue. Don't get panicked, that is not the brain, that is the bloid what you will have. And then you have to go through one more bone layer in order to get the calvaria out. At first, you have the bones not yet complete, and that is why we have those fontanelli. And the bones keep actually being open to allow our brain to grow a little bit more before they fuse and the fontanelli close. The first fontanelli will close in the first quarter of your first year of life. The second fontanelli can stay open until the end of the second life. Now, how does that work? So we have in the membrane of the surrounding our developing brain, we have so-called ossification centers. And we have the osteoblasts coming with the blood supply into those ossification zones and those ossification centers, where they're kind of huddled together. So nice to meet other osteoblasts and then come together, and then they kind of start making those connections via those canaliculi and those gap junctions, those little arm-like structures, and they're making osteoid, and then they are actually attracting more osteoblasts to come to join them, and they are joining in circular fashion around them, and the blood system will bring more osteoblasts into this region, and then they're making more osteoid, and then will then calcify eventually. And we have the situation going on the outside and on the inside of the developing bone. And in between are getting those blood vessels, they're getting trapped in here. And that's why we're having that in here, all the osteoclasts also will be working, and that's why we have the spongy area between those outer and inner compact tissues. We have, that's again the same thing, just in a different way. We have again five steps. We have our mesenchyme, our vascularization brings our osteoclasts towards the ossification center. They are aggregated in these ossification centers, and they start to embed themselves in this extracellular matrix and deposit osteoid. Then the osteoblasts, they are starting to attract more mesenchymal cells that are making this columnar arrangements and secrete more of this wall matrix of the osteoid. And then we have the collagen fibers from those new form trabeculae. They are still randomly oriented, they are spongy. And that is our whole, that's our woven bone, like I told you, those two different ways of making bone matrix. That is still the beginning of that. And that's why we have that in the middle of the of those skull bones, the spongy area. And only later on, we have the outside of those irregular forming bone tissue starting to ossify by having calcium phosphide deposited into the bone matrix, that is the stuff with the seed vesicles. The outside here will get remodeled first before the inside here. And that has happened in the last step, in the final step, where we get our bone, our osteoblasts entrapped by their own matrices, but they also attract those blood vessels here. And that's why we have on the outside this compact area of bone, the diploid. In the inside you have the diploids, or the soft tissue with the trapped blood vessels. That's why you have a hard, soft part when you cut through the cranial bones. Now, let's go to the second type and the more common type of ossification. Almost our whole skeleton, except those few flat folds, are made by our so-called endoshotal ossification. And the endoshotal ossification is the process by which we replace our cartilage precursors with bone tissue. We have the, we also have a primary ossification center, but instead of making that somewhere randomly into a membranous environment, like in the intermembranous ossification, we have our ossification center starting in the center of a cartilaginous precursor of a bone. We start by having blood vessels surrounding our cartilage. That is, they are also in the perichondrium already. And then the capillaries start to infiltrate the center of the cartilage precursor. Now the chondrocytes that are at the area, the shaft of the future bone, they actually go growing old, they're mature, and then they start to hypertrophy. And when they start to hypertrophy, then they are going to start to make collagen 10. So usually they have collagen 2, remember, highly cartilage? And then when they get old, when they're mature, they start to, under the influence of those blood vessels, they start to make type 10 collagen. And type 10 collagen is a typical marker for hypertrophic chondrocytes. Now the collagen 10 will actually start also to make a feedback loop with their own cells, and they start to express VEGF. VEGF, you should have heard it by now from other colleagues of mine, vascular endothelial cell growth factor, basically says more arteries, vascular growth, come to me, it's attracting vascularization. And those blood vessels will now infuse the center of the cartilage and brings with the blood also osteoprogenitors and other blood cells that arrive here. This whole event, from here to here, is then called our is forming our primary ossification center. And all our long bones, it doesn't matter how small or large they are, start with this center of ossification in the shaman region. Histologically, it looks like this. We have here our nice cartilaginous bone. We have the epiphyses here, the round endings. We have our shaft here. Our hypertrophic chondrocytes, you can identify them because they get suddenly really large. And they are usually collected in the middle, in the center of our cartilaginous precursors. While they are getting really large, they are signaling to the outside, to what was previously perichondrium, that in the perichondrium are the cells that have this osteogenic potential. Remember that I told you that those osteogenic cells that don't know can become cartilage or bone? And here, because of the collagen X and VHF, those osteogenic cells, they're not becoming chondroblasts, they're becoming osteoblasts. Now DECA is starting to make a bone cover around the shaft of the dying or hypertrophic cartilaginous cells in the center of the cartilaginous bone precursors. And this early color of bone tissue around the shaft is called periosteal color. Very easy, right? And from here on, the ossification goes towards the epiphyses, going in both directions. Now here again, we form the automatic one. So we form our primary ossification center, and then we attract more blood vessels because we are having now VHF. And then we increase our osteogenic zone, our bone ossification center, into both areas, towards our epiphyses. Okay? The blood vessels bring more osteoblasts. The chondrocytes, they are hypertrophy, so that means they are going to die eventually, making space for the osteoblasts to have room to make osteoids, the extracellulomatous of bones. And then this whole thing starts to get a bone from the center to the outside. But the epiphyses needs a secondary ossification center. We have that at the end of the third one, between the third and the first, we have that at the birth, a secondary ossification center appearing. So this is our begin of our fetal development. In the fetal development, we already start to make this periosteal collar and our primary ossification center. By the 3rd month, most of our long bones have those ossification centers. That's why I could show you earlier on this 12-week-old embryo that had all those red bone-like structures, 255 to 265 bones, right? That is all because of our primary ossification centers. However, our epiphyses doesn't start ossifying before birth. So this area is just the growth of the fetus inside the mom. Or inside the placenta, let's put it that way. Now, after birth, we have more blood vessels going into the epiphyses and forming the so-called secondary ossification center. And also here we have the chondrocytes hypertrophy, undergoing hypertrophy, increasing collagen 10 and VHF expression, therefore attracting the blood vessels. And with the blood vessels come all the osteoblasts and making that bone tissue in the epiphyses. What stays in the middle between the epiphysical, the secondary ossification center, and the primary ossification center is the so-called epiphyseal plate. And that's very important because you don't want to have an adult that's that size, right? Because if you would grow, if we ossify all of this just shortly after in the early childhood, then we couldn't grow anymore. So we need the epiphyseal plate to keep growing. And that happens here in those plates that stay cartilaginous until we are adult. This is basically what I just told you, that the secondary center is also invaded by blood vessels, and then the most outer part of the epiphyses stay cartilaginous because that becomes our articular cartilage. So our articular cartilage is there from the beginning. For the long growth, we need our epiphyse in the brain. And now there are in the literature two different things going on. Some only focus on the epiphyseal plate, and you don't find something that's called the metaphysis. So the epiphyseal plate is the growth plate between the secondary ossification center and the primary ossification center. The ossification at the shaft diaphysis can be seen here, and then we have a transition zone where we have here in white dying chondrocytes. And here we have blood vessels invading the zone, starting to lay down woven bone structures that will then become restructured as lamellar bone to make adult bone, right? This overlapping zone where we have blood vessels from the diaphysis invading the epiphyseal plate, this growth plate in the middle between epiphyses and diaphyses, is called in many books metaphyses. However, when you look at YouTube videos, international sources, and also the book that I gave you, you will find only the epiphyseal plate. So don't get confused. Epiphyseal plate is basically all this cartilage and so on until the hypertrophic cartilage cells, is the chondrocytes. And then the transition zone, where the blood vessels are invading the dying chondrocytes. That is the metaphysis. But this area here, that is what makes the growth of our long bone. And that is what I'm showing you in the following slides. So here, that is basically the summary this time before the different steps. We have here the color code. You see this big zone? This is the zone of preserved cartilage. Those are chondrocytes that still have the ability to proliferate. Then you have a zone of cell proliferating. Those are the ones that are still proliferating, and they're proliferating so fast that I can't make the extracellular matrix fast enough to separate each other. That's why they are looking like they are on stacks. See how closely they are together? And then they kind of get exhausted, and then you have here a zone of cell hypertrophy. So they've stopped making mitosis, they've stopped doing the cell proliferation. They're getting larger and larger until they've stopped also to do any physiological processes, and then they're starting to die. And when they're starting to die, that is when they do the VEGF and collagen 10 production. That is the zone of calcification, because we have now the blood cells invading this area of the dying cartilages and bringing this time the osteoblasts. And the osteoblasts will then take the space over, and then we get into the zone of bone deposition. That is where we break down the lacunae of the chondrocytes to make space for the osteoblasts. A little bit slow, and again, we have four zones. We have a reserve zone, right? We have a proliferation zone, a hypertrophic zone, and an ossification zone. The ossification zone is the zone that's often called the metaphysis. This transition zone is being called the wall. In the reserve zone, that is mainly hyaline cartilage, there is not much happening there. But they are providing the osteoblastic cells to the proliferation zone, where we have the cells starting to run. And it's called also the zone of proliferation, it's also called the running zone, because they are proliferating so fast, see, so fast, that I can't make enough extracellular matrix to separate them from each other. In the proliferation zone, we have a very fast proliferating, and that is regulated by Indian hedgehog and again our parathyroid hormone. So our parathyroid hormone is not only regulating the osteoblast function to regulate the osteoblast differentiation, but it is also regulating the proliferation or the growth of the cartilaginous proliferation zone. At the end of the growing period, so when we are in women 16 to 20 and men 18 to 22, then we stop this circle of parathyroid hormone and Indian hedgehog, and we basically lose the zone of proliferation. The zone of proliferation makes this enlargement of our long bones. When we stop those hormones, then we lose the salt, and then all this cartilage that's left here, except the most upper one that becomes in our articular cartilage, that will be becoming the hypertrophic. Then we go to our next zone. There is this area here where they get larger and larger, and they're slowing down with all physiological processes until they get so large that they're starting to die. Like they're getting old. So they're, when they're dying, it's called apoptosis, as you already know, and then they're going to express, they're going to make collagen 10, and they're going to express VEGF. And in that area now, they're starting to also separate much more because of the collagen 10. And because of the VEGF, they are starting to attract blood vessels. And that is now our vascular invasion zone, that's here, where the blood vessels start to go into the space where the concentration of VEGF is the highest. That is the, also the region where we have the highest apoptotic rate of the chondroblasts, of the chondrocytes. Now, the hypertrophic chondrocytes, they are affecting the mineralization of themselves, of their matrix around them, and attracting the ossification by secreting FGF and saying that the blood vessels come to me, bring all the osteoblasts. They are also recruit macrophages or chondroblasts to actually clean up the mess from all those dying chondrocytes. Now, you will say like, oh, but Dr. C, you never talked about chondroblasts, because they are not relevant for you. They are only active in this area. Otherwise, all the other cartilage debris is taken care of by macrophages from the immune system. So please don't bother to learn about chondroblasts. They are only active in this growing zones. They are cleaning up the space, but now the blood vessels have to go in to make the to bring the osteoblasts. On the outside of the diaphysis, we have now the chondrocytes of the perichondrium instructing the chondrogenic cells to make osteoblasts instead of chondroblasts to make our bone powder. And then the hypertrophic cells, they will also make pipette collagen, what is a marker of themselves, what is attracting again more of the chondroblasts. And when they are done, it's making sure that we are now getting osteogenesis in that area, they're going to die. Now, in this calcification zone, then, the lower zone, the upper zone of the so-called metaphysis, they are going to have the blood vessels pumping the blood into that area, having a clean-up crew for the dead cell material, and also bringing our osteoblasts and beginning to lay down osteoids to make bone. We see also very nice at the beginning, all the spongy bone here. We have the so-called bone spicules that are all spongy bone here. And we saw it is going in this direction. We see here a secondary ossification center. We have here, that is our periosteal collar. And the bone spicules, they're getting connected, forming the sponge-like structures here. Because from this side, there are also osteoblasts following that area to make then our bone marrow cavity. You can see those epiphyseal growth plates still in X-rays, and therefore you can estimate the age of a person, because we have all of our body, we have different times when our growth zones of the long bone fuse. So when you make an X-ray of the hand, you can estimate the age of a child, because our hands are one of the first that actually ossify. That's why when you have large hands as a child, then you will have always large hands. If you have small hands as a child, well, then luck, then look at me, small hands will stay small, it doesn't matter how tall you get. The long bones of our lower extremities, they are the latest to fuse. That's why we have sometimes also women that have a very short upper trunk and short arms, but their legs that can be going very long. That is basically when the upper extremity stops growing earlier than the legs. Now when we have the whole life, we have our bones and osteoarthritis are stiff under stress, and that can cause microcracks. And then we have those microcracks, then we start actually a signaling cascade. We are going to have that wrinkle in the bloodstream that will attract our osteoclast precursors. Remember that osteoclast precursors will have rank, and wrinkle is the ligand, and rank is the receptor that's on the surface of the osteoclast precursors. They're getting attracted by the sudden increase of those dying osteocytes. And they are coming then in this area of increased rank and to start eating up the weak area of the bone to clean it air, to clean it up. So here's what written down in the whole thing. We have microcracks, right? That the osteocytes, they are in this microcrack, they're undergoing apoptosis. When they undergo apoptosis, they are secreting this rank ligand. And then the apoptotic cells, they signal the surrounding still healthy cells to make those wrinkles. And then wrinkles actually attract the osteoclasts, which then attach to the pre-osteoclastic surfaces and then commit to the osteoclast differentiation. And then they can actually clean up the area where we have those weakened bone. And now the whole remodeling starts. The osteoclasts, our little bones, they're eating up the microcrack area. They're like the waste cleanup group. And then the osteoclasts, they're coming from behind and building again the bone matrix. And then in the beginning, you have the blood vasculature that is bringing all the osteoclasts, new osteoclasts in there. And then you have the concentric apposition of the osteoid of the matrix laid around in circles to make them again those osteoids to repair this damage. Now this whole process is very complex, and now I'm not going to tell you everything about it, just wanted to show you. And this whole remodeling thing is really cool because it's going on the whole life. That means if I would now suddenly start at my old age to think I want to be a weightlifter, you know, midlife crisis, I want to do something new. And I would start now going to a fitness studio and start weightlifting. My bone density will increase because of the increased demands. Similarly, if I would live a little bit more healthy, I could also decrease my bone density a little bit and for adjusting to hold my weight, right? So if I would lose some weight, then my lower extremity would have told me that much, so my bone density would be decreasing. Now, if you say you are heavy because you have dense bones, it's nonsense. No, you don't. Even if I would lose 10 pounds, my bone density would not relate to half of that weight. Most of the time when you lose weight, it's really water and fat tissue, and that is weight specific. The change in the bones itself is not that much because you have all the spongy bones and it's very light on itself. You change a little bit on the outside of the compact bone when you're losing weight because that is the part that is the weight bearing thing. So your bone thickness will not change significantly enough to show it on the scale. But you can see it in the older, in the x-rays, you can see the bone density changing over time. Now when we have a bone fracture, we have a similar mechanism going on where we have the blood tissue bringing in osteoclasts as well as osteoclasts. We first have a callus formation, that is an inflammation where we have macrophages eating up and helping the osteoclasts, cleaning up the area. And then we have a callus formation also with making those cartilaginous area here first. And then the blood vessels bring more osteoclasts and osteoclasts that make first spongy bone, similar like in the primary ossification center. And then the whole spongy bone will be remodeled to compact bone until it actually is exactly the same as the previous bone. So if you wait long enough, you can't really see healing processes anymore. And that's why bones are the only structures in our bodies that can heal without scarring. That's cool, isn't it? And that's actually survived histology. Congratulations, everyone. So I'm aware that we have the exam for this lecture in Asia. So please, email me. You can email me anytime. There's no need to apologize for sending me at 2 a.m. an email. If that's the time you want to send me an email, please do it. I'm not reading my emails at 2 a.m. But you don't need to apologize for sending emails at any time. Just send them, ask me what you want, and then I offer you as soon as I'm back on my computer. If you have questions to my muscle histology lecture, also the same thing, just email me. If you want to make a class document where you collect all my questions into one document, just send me a Google file and let me know, hey, Dr. C, there are some questions for you. I go to the Google file and answer the questions there. I don't care how you do it, but if I answer your questions and you think your classmates might have similar questions, please share the information, okay?